find you very rude.
The Novimbia Chanel is made possible by our gorgeous patrons who get early access, exclusive content and buyer's remorse. And a happy Halloween to our brand new patrons Lucas Howe, Fuchs Stern, Lucas P, Harry Jenner, Timmy Perry, Trevor Pugh and Bumble Scrums. Let's start the shit show. Are we on?
Yeah.
You're right.
Welcome to the car. Welcome to this Novimbia treat. A bleak, grim tour of Bournemouth. We're going to go to some hot spots. We're going to go... the scenes of crimes, of grim, creepy goings-on. We're going to try and park up outside all of them. There's about six, maybe.
Because it's Halloween, it's spooky season.
Have you turned the microphone on?
Yes.
Oh, thank God for that. We've got some notes. We're going to have a little story time. Shah. Well,
don't you zoom in on my face. That's not like a certified peg.
We are a certified peg. We could start talking about the first location we're going to, actually, is a little shop in... The area is called Branksome, right, Shah?
Yes.
It's on the Poole Road, and we're going to look at a shop.
A shop that was once owned by local businessman, 36-year-old John Green.
...of a straightforward, well-liked man for no reason anyone can work out. John Green was in his mid-30s. He wasn't a very ambitious man, and he made a basic living from a variety of occasional jobs.
John was murdered in his shop in Branksome on February the 1st, 1991. His body was discovered the next day by his fiancée, who immediately became a suspect in the investigation. E-fits were released of potential suspects, but despite a Crime Watch segment and TV programme about the case, police considered that there was a lack of interest in finding John's killer from the general public. John's ex-fiancée maintains a Facebook page dedicated to him.
And to this day, nobody has any idea why he was killed or who did it.
I will say, though, and I don't know if it's gonna, like... I don't know, I was gonna say that one of the E-fit drawings looks like my auntie's husband.
That would be your uncle.
Well, no, because he's not, like, they're not married or anything. Well, so he's not even her husband, right?
Just lying.
Yeah, but it still could be him, though, Shah.
Have you told the police this?
No.
Christ!
Could you imagine if I accidentally solved it, like, just in this video? You're in the wrong gear.
No, I'm not in the wrong gear.
You're doing 20 miles an hour.
What are you on about?
I told you you're driving,
Shah. You don't do anything. Right, Shah, quick. I'm going left here.
Yeah.
And then what? Is that where the retail park is? Here we can stop into John Lewis.
For what reason?
Might get a nice cushion, but get a nice one. Oh, there's nowhere to park here either, is there?
Yeah, it'd be fine.
Across the street, so we're talking about, we'll get out in a minute.
You can't see anything.
Fourth one from the right. We're gonna get out, we're gonna go and stand in front of it, and then maybe try and get round the alley in the back, is the shop. What is it now, Shah?
It's called Nada, but I don't know what it is. Jen said it might be a salon.
It looks like a salon from the outside because they had a bunch of ring lights inside, but I don't know.
So I thought it was older than 36. He was killed there in a frenzied knife attack. He was stabbed several times and the killers have never been found. He was stabbed so brutally that the knife entered and came out his back. Like, it went in the front and came out the back.
One of his injuries, yeah.
And he was discovered by his fiancé.
The fiancé, there's a thing with the fiancé, isn't there?
Because she went, and she went to go see him the night before, was it?
Yes.
And there was, and the TV was still on. She went in through the front of the shop. He lived in the basement downstairs, that's important. We didn't say that, did we?
Right.
So he lived in the basement downstairs, and she went in through the shop to go see him. Went downstairs, the TV was still on, there was food. She could smell food burning on the hob that had been left on.
Right.
She thought he'd gone out and forgot that he was cooking, so she had to rush off. So she wrote him a note and left again, went back the next day and everything was still there. The note was still there. And she thought it was a bit weird that he'd gone without saying anything. So she went up into the shop again to, like, see if he'd left, like, an answer phone message, I think it was.
And that's when she found him?
And that's when she found him, like, dead on the floor with his eyes open.
What, behind the shop?
In the shop.
Back of the shop.
On the desk. Yeah, behind, like, a solid wood desk. And it's literally, like, it wasn't, like, in a different room. It's literally, like, one room, the shop.
But this is why the police thought that she had done it.
Because it was weird that she would have been there and not seen him.
Yeah, but she said it was behind
the... Why would you go to the back of the shop behind the desk?
She said, like, I was looking for a... She was like, a solid wood desk, and I was just... she goes, I wasn't looking for a body. She was like, yeah. I didn't realise he'd be lying on the floor behind the desk.
And you didn't see his body?
No. I wasn't looking for a body laying there, was I?
Which is very, like, true.
And the police tried to convince her that she had done it and forgotten.
Yeah, or that she was lying and that she'd definitely done
There's
it.
There's actual kind of audio tactic. Recordings of this online, and you can hear them saying, are you sure you didn't just forget? It was like in a blind fit of rage.
It is a hair salon.
My house is literally at the end of that road there, so it's really close to my house, which is why I'm slightly, like, obsessed with the case. So, like, the day before, was it that he was last seen, or the day that he was last seen? I can't remember, but he was seen... an eyewitness saw two guys, like, jostling him, I think was the word they used, in the front of the shop, in the doorway.
What were we talking about the alleyway? What was that?
So, behind Jen, where that hedge is, there's an alleyway which leads all the way behind, which his friends said they would never go down there. Because it was so creepy at night. They'd always go through the front of the shop, down into the basement to get to his apartment.
So why? So there was an entrance to his apartment through this alleyway, was it?
Yeah, so you can...
Flat and stuff from the back, but... Yeah, we should go down there. I feel sick. Wait, oh no, is it round the back of that?
Don't know, don't see.
It might be round the back of here. Well, let's look over this fence, over the wall.
I'm not catching
charges though.
Oh, this is it.
It's gated off.
The alleyway is not as accessible today as it was in 1991. This may have served as an entry point for whomever killed John Groom.
So the bus, can you see the bus stop behind me?
Yeah.
There were like two old women who got on the, pensioners they said, who got on the bus, who saw someone came out of the shop at the same time as the bus pulled up, and they were keen to speak to the two women, and I think someone got off as well, but they never found out who it was. But they could have been like a key person to see who the murderer was. They just never said anything. This is like his local. The landlord and landlady at the time retired and moved to California, I think it was. So the police flew, like, all the... Well, we got a car. The police flew to California to interview them. Like, that's how, like, high profile it was.
They didn't get anything out of them, though, did they?
No, there was no, like, they couldn't think of anybody. Like, who did, because they wanted to interview them to see, like, because they obviously knew him, because he went there all the time, because that's where it is, and then his place is there, so.
I must just first apologise for the state of my hair in that wind.
But yeah, but there's no, you can't really do much, can you?
No.
Yeah, but
well,
the when whole thing's like... just going to flop off in one thing, one go.
Like Donald
lump.
Trump.
The only thing that they had to go on is that some people thought he was selling fake drugs. Do you remember in the documentary when they said he might
what
be selling...
What was the shop before? Like, what actually was
well,
the shop?
Well, it wasn't anything, it was it?
So the windows were, like, whitewashed out. And, oh, that's another thing to mention, is that the reason that they couldn't find any, like, evidence or fingerprints or anything like that is because a week before the murder, he'd had a house party with, like, 50 people for one of his friends. So there was, like, tons of, like, DNA everywhere and fingerprints and that. So that was the reason that they couldn't, like, they had, like, no one really to go on. The shop was nothing. They
What, was it, like, it was being done into something, was it? Or
well,
was it just empty?
I think he loaned a load of money from the bank to...
He was going to start a fibre optic security something company for, like, yachts, whatever the fuck that is. But it didn't work. He lost a load of money.
Yeah, and he owed a load of money, so they think that he turned to selling drugs instead, or, like, fake drugs. Like, he made...
So that would have made him kind of like a target.
He would make
these, like, tablets, these bricks out of, like, wax and try and pass it off as drugs.
Oh my god.
Well, that's not been proven, but a few people thought he was doing that.
Yeah.
which would make him a prime target, really.
Well, where there's smoke, there's fire, I'd say. If people were saying that, they're not saying it for no reason at all, are they?
Yeah.
So, that was stop number one, was that little tiny shop down there. We're going to put links in the description to kind of like Facebook pages and stuff you can go to for further reading. But now we're going to move on.
Stop the car, there's a Lidl.
Oh my god! Right, we're heading towards Tregonwell Road, right, Shah?
Wait, mow her down, don't you?
No, don't mow her down.
No, we get another stop for the
She's a little old deer. We're currently at the location where she mowed someone down. We're going to Tregonwell Road, which was the scene in the 60s of a
murder whose subsequent trial would only last 52 seconds. In 1964, a man named Ramsay Dorwood Shannon was convicted of the murder of his German girlfriend, Gisela Meyer, which occurred in the heart of Bournemouth at 3 Tregonwell Road.
At this roundabout, you want to take the left.
Right. I don't know if this house is still a house or if it's been converted into something, but we're looking for number 3, so...
I think it might be the other end.
Is this the end of the road?
I think so, yeah. So I think it'll be...
That's 30.
Is this still Tregonwell Road?
Yeah, well, I reckon it might go down... Oh, Tregonwell Upper Terrace.
Oh, wait a minute.
Oh, yeah, so I can go down there, sure.
You can't turn right down there. There's no entry.
No, but I can go down here.
Yes, which is still Tregonwell Road.
1811. Oh, it'll be down the end then. But then that doesn't look like there would be enough there. I mean, is it like a house or is it more of a...
I don't know if it's like a flat situation now. I don't know whether...
These are a row of like...
They're very narrow.
It's at the end of like this row of flats slash houses. This one here. I'll get a better shot of it in a minute.
So we are parked outside 3 Tregonwell Road and there's a man standing right there. And if he goes in the front door, I'm tempted to grab him and be like, do you know someone died?
No, because then we'd have to like sign a release form to be in the video and
Who are we? The BBC? Calm down. This was the home of a man called Ramsay Dorwood Shannon, and he was convicted of the murder of a German woman called Gisela Meyer. So he killed her here on the 27th of July 1964. So they first met at the Studley Hotel, which I've looked it up and I don't think that exists anymore because I can't find it anywhere. You can see super old pictures of it. So
a shit ton of hotels like around here, isn't there? So there's probably so one of them.
In Bournemouth in general, a shit ton. It's no longer there, but they both worked at this hotel, right? 1964. But they started this relationship. It started out pretty good, but she would comment and say how jealous he was becoming. And she said to him, it would be better if they were just friends, right? And on that day, he decided that he made a vow. If she would not be his, then nobody would ever. It's that old chestnut, isn't it? I don't know. That seems like not a great sign.
No.
Neither if I can't have you, no one can.
I mean...
Do you know what I'm saying?
You guys are not in a position to break up. No one else is going to take either of you.
Sham!
Both Shannon and Meyer were living at the residence, but while she was working at the Studley Hotel, he set about preparing the murder.
He made her bed, cleaned her room, which he nearly always did. He then went to an ironmonger's down the hill. So again, that will be somewhere down that way.
Yeah.
And this is the centre of Bournemouth, so there's shops all the way like along this there, road yeah. here. It was called Kitchener's, but again...
What's an ironmonger's?
Well, they sold iron stuff. He bought a knife there. So they would have sold metal, right?
I thought you meant irons. Like when you said that, I mean, stuff, I was like, what, ironing boards?
But again, there's no record of where that shop was. And he bought a knife, which cost 12 shillings and 3 pence. And after buying the knife, he went back to this house. He hid it under the mattress and he waited for her to get back from work from Studley.
So horribly premeditated.
Hotel. He planned it for weeks, it said.
Oh my God, that's so horrible.
And in his statement, he said, what I have written is horrible and gruesome, but I still love my little angel Gisela. I mean, he was clearly slightly unhinged. Anyway, went to the beach about 6:30, met a number of people, and then at 7:30 he went back to 3 Tregonwell Road, which is where we are, and he waited for her to come home. So when she returned, he said he told her that he had not been at work for a few days, which displeased her, but he asked her to forgive him, and she did.
Gisela was an English language student, so she decided to read to Ramsay Dorwood from a religious book while they lay about the room at Tregonwell Road.
They spoke for a while about flowers, which Ramsay Shannon said was beautiful, and also about religion until about 10:15 p.m.
They went to bed. She wasn't very amused with the idea that he wanted to get into bed with her, which probably doesn't signal a great relationship, eh? She got half-dressed and told him that it was all over between them, and he asked her if she really meant it, and she said yes. He got off the sofa and went towards her and asked her again. He got the same reply, and so he stabbed her in the back. He said, I came nearer and asked her again. I got the same reply, and from under my blue pullover, which I had in my arm, I drew the knife and plunged it into her poor dear back. She stood up amazed but said nothing. How creepy is that?
Oh, my God. It gets worse.
Imagine not knowing what to say because you're like, there's a fucking knife in my back. I then pushed her on the floor, and to my horrible shame, I did it again to her front. At around 11:20, a man who was visiting his sister in a room at 3 Treadmill Road.
So it's
flats within.
Like fence, maybe.
Yeah, it's like a... Each level might have like a different...
I want to know which room it was.
Thing, and I know you do. Yeah, I would quite like to know, but there's no record of that. After killing her, Ramsay Shannon went to the square in Bournemouth, which would have taken him like 3-4 minute walk down
the hill. Yeah, it's not far at all.
Where he found a policeman and said to him, I want to confess to killing my girl. The policeman said that he then took Ramsay Shannon to a police box. Ramsay Shannon said, I did it, she's dead. You will be too late. The knife is still there at 3 Tregonwell Road.
And that happened just here.
So we've done Poole Road and Tregonwell, which I don't know if it's pronounced Tregonwell, it might even be Tregonal, I don't know, who cares? And we're now on our way to Manor Road to talk about a murder that occurred in the 30s, that actually was the inspiration for a stage show. It was a real big deal back in the day. Especially in Bournemouth, where people used to go to convalesce for illnesses. It was supposed to be sounded kind of like a, you know, charming seaside. It was good for your health. It was like nothing of significance ever happened here. So for this to happen in Bournemouth was like a big deal.
The year was 1934, and Francis and Alma Rattenbury were enjoying a comfortable married life in their home on Manor Road in Bournemouth. The Rattenburys placed an advertisement in the Bournemouth Echo newspaper requesting a daily willing lad for housework, and by doing so had set into motion one of the most salacious murder trials Bournemouth had ever seen.
Okay, so we're going to 5 Manor Road, which is also known as, used to be known as Villa Madeira in the 30s, and it's the scene of the Rattenbury murder. Which is something that people don't really talk about anymore, but at the time it was a big deal.
So we're gonna get to like a really weird shape, like turn shit in a minute. You wanna turn right.
It's quite creepy around here with all these massive trees, isn't it?
It's right pretty,
here.
Pretty.
It's down there.
Yeah. So it's saying that number 5, there's nowhere to park, really.
It's there.
It's there, yeah.
That's it.
We park somewhere. There's a taxi behind you.
Look, I'll park in this hotel just here. Can I?
The position of houseboy was offered to 18-year-old George Stoner, who quickly became enamoured with Alma, who was considerably younger than her husband Francis. At the time, Alma was a celebrated musician who performed under the name Lausanne. Alma was considered a rare beauty of her time and would have a total of 3 husbands in her short life. Francis, an esteemed architect, had become depressed and impotent and didn't object to the affair that would ensue between his wife Alma and the houseboy George. George, on the other hand, became increasingly jealous of Alma's relationship with Francis, and so in November of 1934, he took a mallet and struck Francis about the head. Both Alma and George would privately confess to the murder of Francis Rattenbury, but only George would be convicted of the crime, receiving a sentence of death by hanging. Overcome with the grief of her lover's impending death, Alma Rattenbury would travel to the Three Arches Bridge in Christchurch, where she left some notes on the riverbank before plunging a knife into her heart. She died in the River Avon, not knowing that George had had his death sentence commuted to a prison sentence, as there had been a public outcry for the young boy, led astray by a devious older woman. George Stoner died in Christchurch Hospital in 2000 at the age of 83, only a short walk from where Alma killed herself. He went to the grave having never revealed who really committed the murder of Francis Rattenbury.
impressions of the Rattenbury House?
Having seen it now, I thought it was a lot bigger than that. There were a lot of people who lived there, and it wasn't even that big. It was like a glorified bungalow.
I think it's really, fucking creepy. Like, it's set back away from the road. It's got a lot of like hedges and stuff around it, and it's just like a different height. Like, it's quite a short house. It's just, it does.
It looks really out of place.
It looks really old as well. It's still got like lattice windows that are all like single glazed, and it's all a bit run down.
There are so many giant buildings around here. There's so many hotels, and
that's a very modern building here as well.
There's so many massive buildings, and yet the Rattenbury House is so small.
Look at this one as well. This is really modern.
You know what it looks like? Do you remember that game on the PC that was like Grandma's House?
Yeah.
Do you remember when you have to try and escape and then there's a witch? Do you ever play that?
No. I thought it was a lot bigger. There was a lot of people who lived there. Who was it? It was her and him, the couple.
Yeah.
Son from her first marriage, their own child, her maid,
and the houseboy.
That's six people. That is not a six-bedroom house.
I think
house.
It's one of those houses that looks more, is deceiving. Yeah, I reckon it's probably quite big.
Might go back quite far.
The houseboy whacked him over the head with a mallet.
I think it was the houseboy did it. I think George Stoner did it. And she just sort of also, was like, well, no, I did it, to try and help him out, because she was desperately in love with him.
If he said, I will never tell who it was, that was obviously him then, wasn't it? Because she killed herself. He could have pinned the blame on her and been like, yeah, it was her.
Yeah,
I'd have done that.
I think he did it for sure.
So we're arriving at the Wimborne Road Cemetery, also known as Cemetery Junction, because we are going to try to find the final resting places of Frances and Alma Rattenbury. Frances, of course, being the one she may have killed.
Don't really know, Dallin. Where the fuck is the entrance, Shah, please?
I don't know, just carry on following.
There's around. Something up here. I'm pretty sure it's up here.
Yeah, because it was like diagonally along, I think.
So we know what his grave looks like, and we know from the perspective of a certain building where it is located.
But and it's by a tree, but there are lots of trees. What are you doing? Are you parking here?
Well, yeah. Isn't this an entrance? Yeah, look, right here. This is fine, isn't it?
That family was really weird. They were like watching us when we turned the corner, and then by the time we parked up, they were walking past us and looking at us. And now they've just walked back again, back on themselves.
It's
and they're like
we're
still
famous.
Watching us. I don't think that's it. I really don't like this. The fact that it's like somewhere in there means we're gonna have to like walk through graves to get to it, and I feel
not
very
not necessarily.
Sick.
We have a picture of Frances's grave, and we feel like we can try and figure it out from the angle it was taken, from the perspective of the church in the background, but it might take us a minute.
I think this is quite where that tree is. I think it might be wrong.
So he didn't have a grave for a very, very long time. I think they managed to get him one in 2007, which is why it looks so new. She apparently is buried very nearby, and it's a very small,
shit,
it's very, very small black sort of cube.
Not that one there. Would it also be a modern one? Or
I think modern-ish. So his grave is over there. Hers, we found it, is this little tiny. Shall I just move the
this bit? Oh God, I don't want to touch it.
Can you see it? There we go.
Lausanne.
Rattenbury. 1935. Lausanne was her stage name.
Ah.
I think she wrote music and performed under Lausanne.
How interesting.
And hers is a tiny, tiny little one.
Do we know why hers is so tiny?
Well, I guess because she wasn't very favourable, was she?
Oh, okay.
They probably just kind of popped that there and thought that'll do.
She was potentially a killer.
I find it quite interesting how they both have, like, flowers on, like, fake flowers. Do you reckon it's left by the same person? They look like they're from the same.
Well, there's a groundskeeper, isn't there, who would do shit like that?
No, they don't put flowers on.
They wouldn't
on.
Put but flowers on.
They're fake flowers, but they're not overly sun-bleached. Like, they've not been there for that long.
No, and those ones aren't either. Those are still yellow.
Well, there is a descendant, I think, who's still alive. He's about 70 something. I can't remember
can't
his name.
Be much older than maybe like a couple of years.
There is potentially someone who could have done that.
That's so interesting.
So there they are. The final resting place are the Rattenburys. And we just went to their dirty little house.
The story of Alma Rattenbury was the inspiration for a play called Cours Célèbre, which in 1987 was adapted for TV, starring Helen Mirren as Alma.
I can't even see like a path to get out of here. So there are 43,000 people buried here.
Notable interments: Sir Evelyn Baring, 1st Earl of Cromer. I don't know what that means. He was a statesman. His name was Evelyn. Christopher Crabcreek, who I think opened or built the church and the cemetery. No mention of the Rattenburys whatsoever, which I would have said was a notable interment considering the murder, but...
So, having left the cemetery where we saw the Rattenburys, we passed through a town, an area of Bournemouth called Lansdowne. This wasn't exactly part of the tour, but Shah told us as we were passing through that on the left, we're coming up to a KFC, which she told us was the place where a reality star, Jade Goody's father, passed away. He died in a bathroom cubicle. He overdosed. And apparently that was the reason that Jade Goody found it very difficult to return to Bournemouth. But it's just a worthy tidbit of adding in. It wasn't really supposed to be part of the tour, but Charmaine insisted we talk about it. So this KFC coming up here on the left is, it was the place where Jade Goody's father died.
So we are now approaching the church where Mary Shelley is buried. Which way am I going, Sean?
Right.
So, what's the name of this church? St. Peter's?
I think it's the St. Peter's Church.
I think it is.
This is the final resting place of Mary Shelley, who very famously wrote Frankenstein. The pub across the street is called the Mary Shelley.
It's behind the church.
We'll flash it as we go past. They've put some Frankenstein heads out for Halloween, which is a bit cute.
Right, so we have actually seen this before, and I'm fairly certain it's just up these stairs. Oh, there's a little marker just there on the right-hand side of the stairs, and I'm fairly certain that will tell you where it is.
We are here.
Number 4 is Mary Shelley. We are here. It is just up and then there.
You can see where a lot of people have come here because the grass has worn away a bit. There we go.
So her full name is Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley. Which is a name, isn't it?
She was born in 1797, she died in 1851, so she never knew Netflix.
She never even knew it. The inspiration for Frankenstein came from a nightmare she had, apparently. And it's considered one of the first early examples of science fiction, Sha.
It is.
So, here's the church. And Mary's buried around that corner. And then right here is... the Mary Shelley Free House. Oh, it's a Wetherspoon, what a shame. But they've put Frankenstein heads there, which is adorable.
And look on that, you can see them from the front.
And there's a TK Maxx.
Having departed Mary Shelley's grave, we're now approaching a building, it's just here on the right, and we can park around the front, hopefully.
Is a block of flats, I think, now called Tollard Court, but it used to be, yeah, that pigeon, or that seagull was dancing with death on it. I think we could just park up on this yellow line here because we're not going to be here long. It used to be a hotel called the Tollard Royal Hotel, and this was where a man called Neville Heath stayed after he fled London, where he murdered a little lady that he'd had a little thing with one evening, and he stayed here.
In 1946, Neville Heath travelled to Bournemouth and took a room at the Tollard Royal Hotel under the alias Group Captain Rupert Brooke. He did so following the murder of Marjorie Gardner, whose ankles and wrists had been bound. She was found with bite marks and diamond-shaped lashes on her body. In Bournemouth, Heath met Doreen Margaret Marshall, a wren who was discharged with influenza and sent to convalesce on the south coast. Whilst walking along the prom on Wednesday, 3rd of July, Marshall encountered Neville Heath, who was at first sight handsome and well-spoken.
He would have gone down the road down there, which leads across the seafront, and walking along that seafront is where he would have met the lady in Bournemouth that he killed, and she was the one staying at the Norfolk, which is called the Norfolk Royal now. I feel like it used to just be called the Norfolk.
I was gonna say, I've stayed in that hotel before. The first time I ever came to Bournemouth, because I used to live in Derbyshire in the Midlands, so I would have been really, really small. Came for like a holiday to visit my grandparents who lived in Bournemouth, and we stayed in that hotel, and I always remember because it was pink. And I used to think it was like, oh my god, we're at the seaside, this is so fancy.
And little did you know that was the last place that poor cow stayed in.
They spent the day together and dined at the Tollard Royal in the evening, but upon becoming wary of his intentions, decided to order a cab. Heath objected and offered to walk Marshall back himself.
We are right on the seafront here. Yeah, look, you can see out and see there's ships and stuff.
We then left the Tollard Royal Hotel and drove to Branksome Dean Chine, where Marshall's body was discovered.
I always thought that Chine was like the... When I was little, we used to go to Alum Chine all the time, and we'd say, like, walking through the Chine would be going down towards the beach through all the greenery, and it was like a rainforest.
So when, in reading about this, and it was quite an old, like, testimony that I read, it was the park was called Branksome Dean Chine. Anyway, the point is, we've just driven from Tollard Court, previously the Tollard Royal Hotel, right, which was where they last were before they left, and that was the last time anyone saw her alive. So that drive took us what, about 10 minutes?
You're just under
ish, something like that. But how long would that take to walk? Saying you were going along the seafront.
Along the seafront, it would not that long. I reckon it would be like a 10-minute walk, 15-minute walk.
No, do you really
think I walked from Branksome Dean Chine Beach to Alum Chine Beach, which is the next one, and then Bournemouth further on than that. So it would be, well, maybe about 20 minutes then, 20-minute walk. It's a straight line.
From that hotel we were just at, from the block of flats.
It would literally be like 20 minutes.
20 minutes. And you can get from the seafront up to this area just here.
Yes.
Okay. Because my question was going to be like, where did he kill her? Was it on the seafront? And then he, like, carried her some other way? Or you think that they just got to this park and then he killed her here?
I don't know. That seems to me... If I was there, I'd be a little bit like, oh, well, I'm not walking that way with you because we're going...
Especially because she was a bit uncomfortable with...
And she was in the wrong fucking direction, too. Like,
well, that's the thing I don't understand.
Like, say his hotel was here, her hotel was over here, and she was found over here. Yeah. So, like...
So why did she...
Why did she walk this way with him when she knew that she lived...
Unless, of course, he's like, oh, let's just go by some place I want to show you first. But you would think, considering she wanted to get away.
She was already, like, nervous about being with him. I don't know why she didn't just wait for a fucking taxi.
I will fucking look up the Oxford Dictionary definition of the word.
This is what I consider to be the charm.
Right, Shah, of course, this is all the chine. But you were asking what a chine actually is.
Let's see, look.
Oh my God, Shah, all you're doing is proving me absolutely right.
What?
That it's where the sea comes into the coastline, and that's what makes a chine. So this is Branksome Dean Chine.
We're no longer talking about the chine.
I was never arguing where it was. I was trying to explain to you what it was.
Nice.
Hey, look, chine. The point is, we've followed the story now.
And she was supposedly found in a rhododendron bush, and there's rhododendrons all around here.
So she wasn't found until the 7th of July, when a waitress called Kathleen Evans was out walking her dog through this foresty area, which is a hell of a lot more hilly than I anticipated. I thought it would be more like a flat park, but it's really like a hike trail.
I think as well you can probably walk through
the
car park as well.
We have no idea exactly where, but it was somewhere in this kind of foresty area when this woman noticed a swarm of flies over a rhododendron bush.
Isn't that weird? Like someone's made like a little house there.
Where?
Do you see? Like they made like a little shelter.
Here we go, here's
our dungeon. Yes.
There's one here.
Yes, that's it. And that's quite a big one as well.
With said waxy leaves.
Yeah.
The other ones had the edges of the leaves were too spiky.
You're right.
This is smoother.
Yeah, you're right.
I know, you sound surprised.
It could have been anywhere, like around here, because there's quite a few of these, isn't there? There's like another one down there.
It would be here somewhere. You can probably walk up down there.
Well,
on the map,
it's quite a big area, so it could have been anywhere. We'll never know.
If she saw a swarm of flies, then it must have been pretty close to somewhere where you would walk. So I don't think it would be too far in.
I don't think it'd be too hilly.
It would be either like closer, like that, like all of this is redder than just either be closest like this path here. Or it would be like right down there, like on the edges. But I think it'd be like in one of these areas here.
He was only charged with the murder of Marjorie, the first lady. But I guess since that resulted in a sentence of execution, they probably didn't see a need to chime for the other lady as well. There was, he was declared a psychopath and a sexual sadist, but was not insane. So he didn't manage to get off on a insanity plea. And then he was executed by Albert Pierpoint, who's a very famous executioner, Shah, are you aware?
It's a really interesting name.
I was not.
Pierpoint.
Yeah, he executed, I think, more people in Britain over a certain span in the 19th century than anyone else. Quite famous, but yeah. This is where it happened, Shah.
There's going to be another one.
Get out of here! So having departed Branksome Chine, we're now on our way. Shah, do you want to explain to the viewers what we're doing now?
So we are going to Malmesbury Park Road, where a Korean English language student living in Bournemouth was killed. Her name was Jong Ok Shin, or Oki for short. On the 12th of July 2002, she was murdered in the early hours of the morning as she was walking home from a night out nearby. The person who killed her is a little bit of a grey area, because they think that the wrong man is in prison for her murder. Omar Benguit was thought to be the killer at first.
Well, it's his friends and family that are saying that he's been wrongfully imprisoned.
Yeah, there's a documentary.
As far as a lot of the police are concerned, it's done and dusted, but they really want to get the case reopened.
I think most people think he's innocent. It does seem bullshit.
There's a documentary on YouTube, if you type in, like, The Man With No Alibi, I think it is.
Yeah, that covers it in great depth.
It's a six-part documentary series.
There's a journalist following the Omar Benguet's sister, who is sort of campaigning to get him out of prison, because she believes that Oki was murdered by a guy called Danilo Restivo, who was tried and convicted of a murder two roads away from where we're going. So we're going to go to both sites. The first one is where Oki was murdered, and then the second one is where a lady called Heather Barnett was killed. But considering it was such a short space of time in which the murders happened, in such a short space and in such a similar way,
and there's a whole load of like things that would like could link the two together. Yeah. There's some things that were found at the scene. The dates were the same, and this guy, it turned out he ended up killing three people. He'd killed someone when he lived back in Italy originally.
Yeah,
we're not going there on the tour.
So it's one of these roads on the right, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a bit further down, I think.
So Nova used to live on one of these.
One of these rights.
And on the other side, actually, funnily enough, is the cemetery where we went to see the Rattenbrews. We're going to try and find the exact location where she was found. She was found next to a lamppost, which was basically...
She was leaning on it, wasn't it?
It was literally in front of an alleyway, which Omar Benguet's sister believes was like a getaway route for him, because at the time of night when it was that dark, he could have literally just shot down that alleyway and no one would have seen him.
No, it wasn't that. They thought that he was going to drag her down there, but she screamed and he panicked.
Ah, yes.
Because I think it was a dead end, but his plan, I think, was to drag her down there and then kill her. But so she screamed when he stabbed her.
On the main road.
Yeah, for obvious reasons.
So it'll be on the right hand side.
It's on the right hand side.
287 over there.
Can you see out enough?
Yeah.
That was 289 back there, so it's not that much further down there.
Is it this alley? It's this lamppost here, I think, on the right.
No, it's a green lamppost. I think it might be this lamppost. What's this one?
I think you're right.
It's this one. Yeah, it's this one.
There's no one behind you.
Oh. I could park right here, couldn't I? So this lamppost literally right here is where she was found. She was found also with a clump of hair, which is relevant because Danilo Restivo was dubbed the haircut killer. So Heather Barnett, who was murdered in the road a couple down, was found with a clump of hair. And the girl that he murdered in Italy, who apparently it's like, you could liken it to Madeleine McCann for how famous that is. A little girl in Italy called Elisa Claps was also found years and years later, because she was missing for at least like a decade, probably even more than
that. I think it was like 18 years.
She was also found with a clump of hair in her hand, which is how they connected them all. But this right here is where Oki was found.
Wind the window down.
And that's the alleyway right there. I don't think we should go down it because the fence has...
It looks very residential, doesn't it?
The fence is now broken. In the documentary, the fence was not broken halfway down, so you couldn't get seen, but I feel like that would be literally walking into someone's back garden, which doesn't seem great. You can see how that would be at night, very secluded.
Yeah.
And if she hadn't screamed, he could just drag her through there and that would be that.
Well, I think he was. Yeah, I think they planned to kill her down there, but because she screamed, he panicked and ran. She didn't die. I think she died in hospital, didn't she? Because she didn't name the killer, but she did say that he
had a mask on.
He had a mask. She was able to like kind of identify him. She said he had a mask on. He
a few things.
I can't remember what else it was, but there was a few things that she managed to like say before she died.
But it was on the 12th, wasn't it? And he murdered on the 12th.
He murdered Elisa Claps back in Italy on the 12th, this one happened on the 12th, and then the one that happened a couple of months later to Heather Barnett was also on the 12th. And there was another thing. So the police were stalking Danilo Restivo, filming him undercover. They were watching him in a park, like somewhere nearby. I don't know where it was.
Oh, they were watching him stalk
stalk women, yeah. And they were secretly filming him. And there's like a really creepy shot of him, like crouching down in the bushes, like watching these people.
And they asked him what he was doing.
Well, no, they were so worried that something was about to happen. They were like, he's about to kill. Like, but they didn't blew he their say cover. That
he was like looking for insects or something.
I think he said he was going to catch bugs. He was catching bugs.
I don't know.
And then they looked in his bag and there was like rope, no, change so of they, clothes, and they knife. And like,
they were really worried that something was going to happen. So they blew their cover, said, can you take us back to your car, which was in the car park. And when they went back, they found a knife, some pairs of scissors, a complete change of clothes identical to the ones he was wearing, which was a weird thing anyway, because it was this hot summer's day and he was wearing this massive fat trench jacket coat,
wasn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
It was described as a murder kit.
A murder kit. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that was also on the 12th. So those four dates on the 12th, which is why people, which is like another strong like argument against why
for
they think
serial
Omar,
killer behaviour is.
Well, they think Omar Benguet's innocent, which I kind of agree with, mainly because it was also on the 12th, which is a little bit like.
It's another piece of
to
his.
To tie in, like, yeah.
Yeah, his
and
MO.
This one here happened about 2 months before. Is it Heather Barnett?
Yeah.
Was it 2 months before or something like that? It was not very long at all, but that was also on the 12th of the month.
Yeah. Omar Benguet had some very small sort of drug charges, or he had attacked someone before.
He had lots of run-ins with the law.
He was by no means an angel.
Antisocial behaviour, and there was like drug charges, and like he had a lot of like
he had
a lot of
someone as well before a burglary.
All of the testimony against him was essentially falsified. Was people were coerced into making statements about him.
It was just a bunch of crackheads, just like
who were paid off
to have these charges dropped and this and the other.
So that's why he's in prison, and people are just like, well, clearly it fucking wasn't him.
There's a 6-part documentary series on YouTube, and each episode's like 20 minutes each, I think. It's not very long at all, so the whole thing's like a couple of hours, but it goes into like great detail about the whole thing. It's really interesting.
So we'll now drive over, and you could literally keep the camera rolling, because then we will see just how close.
Do you know how to get there from here?
Yes, I do. In proximity.
We're a bit steamed up again.
The location for where, not only where he lived.
I really hated that.
But he lived opposite Heather Barnett, this Danilo Restivo dude. Yeah, it's just here. I could literally park here.
Which one is it?
So that yellow house there was Danilo Restivo's house. Can you see it? Can you get it?
Yeah, you're a bit fucked up.
That was it.
Kirby. You could wire the window down.
That was his house. I mean, that would have been like a 5-minute walk, not even that, to get to where Oakey died. And then, I do know the address of Heather Barnett's house. I've got a horrible feeling.
It's the one on the left, 211.
It's literally the one that we're parked at.
Yeah.
That is where Heather Barnett was murdered. He had
literally
gone in,
just across the road.
He had gone in under the pretense of having some curtains done, I think, because she was she made curtains, didn't she?
A spare key went missing around the time when he visited her, and then 6 days later, she had all the locks changed, and then 6 days later,
but he'd left her on the bathroom floor for her kids to find.
Oh God, don't, it makes me sick.
And there is audio. There's an audio recording online of the 999 call, the son.
Oh,
yeah.
I need an ambulance and the police.
I've got officers en route. What's happened?
My mum's just been murdered. This is not a joke.
The 999 operator did seem not particularly good in that situation.
Not good at all.
But that's what happened. And when the police arrived, they found Danilo Restivo, obviously not knowing who he was at the time.
He was consoling the kids.
The kids with his girlfriend.
Yeah,
so that would have been literally right here. Fuck knows. But that was his house there that he was in, that yellow one.
Gosh.
So we're now at 37 Abbott Road, which is just behind the camera. And in 1981, August 14th, a police officer named Alan Wood was called to this property because he was told there was something strange going on.
Or was there bollocks?
Even though it was quite a warm day in August, he went in and felt very, very cold. And he saw the television was lying on the floor, lying on the kitchen floor. There was broken glass and china everywhere. As he moved in, he saw a 6-foot dresser in the kitchen
kitchen fall over and crash to the floor. Why is there a dresser in the kitchen? This is all very strange.
Well, yeah,
it's like
but...
one of those ones that you have plates and shit on, not like a dressing table. It's like, you know when you...
Like in Titanic.
Like your nanas, like... Do you know what I mean? Like okay, where it's got like shells and plates yeah, and yeah, shit, yeah. Like decorative plates on.
So he was adamant that he was the only person in the house when that happened, so it couldn't have been somebody pushing it over. Other objects have been flying around the ground floor rooms, and eventually after his visit, a priest was called to conduct an exorcism in this house. Later, a spokesman for the College of Psychic Studies in London said this was classic poltergeist activity. And Alan, the police officer, who was also an author, this was not his first like brush with supernatural activity. And when he was serving in the RAF in the 1940s, he claims to have seen a dark ghostly figure of a First World War pilot in flying clothing standing at the foot of his bed. And he cites Dorset as having one of the most sightings of military ghosts in the country. So it's kind of a bit weird how of all the police officers, he was the one who was called to this property, because it could have been anybody.
Just a quiet little house.
I'd love to know if the people living there have ever experienced anything.
Well, the thing is because I found this, because I follow this page on Facebook called Memories of Paul and Bournemouth, and it's just like, oh, shit. And I think this is where I first heard about the Abbott Road house, and there was like a lot of things going on then. People saying that they used to live near it, or they used to have friends who lived near, and how things would always be happening. That article is the only one that I can find like online, but the ones of people's stories of it, I don't know if search posts, here we are. So someone commented a couple of years ago in this thing saying, my mum told me about a haunted house in Abbott Road, Chalmers, in the late 70s, I think. Does anyone know about this? I tried to Google but can't find anything. There's 138 comments on it.
There's loads of newspaper articles throughout the ages as well about it.
I remember a poltergeist being in a house in Abbott Road, which would be this one. They found two cars on top of one another.
Cars?
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Someone said, very creepy, as we live just around the corner. And someone else said, I was told about the cars. Someone said, is this the house you run about? Someone said, yes, I remember that apparently the police saw strange things happen. It threw children. Someone spoke through the kids. Someone said, yes, I was 4 hours away. I remember the gas meter in midair.
There's a website here, paranormaldatabase.com.
Bournemouth Paranormal Reports. And I think the Abbott Road one is on here. Let me just find. 1981, a family fled their home after a poltergeist outbreak caused chaos. The entity was said to have toppled the kitchen cabinet in front of visiting police, and a priest had his holy water thrown back at him. That is...
Oh my God, May is a poltergeist. Like, have your water. Noises were terrible and things would always be seen flying around the rooms as if being thrown by someone. My mate lived there. She had a bedroom in the loft. I always hurt myself when I was round there, and it was creepy at night. Didn't know about the history of the house until I was older. Someone said that house backed onto my back garden. I lived in Green Road, which is just like running parallel
the next
to this
one, yeah.
And it says it is true. It was a little boy. My dog used to know when the ghost was about because it used to shake. Yeah, some people are saying, like, posting pictures of it saying it looks pretty unassuming now, which I guess it kind of does. It doesn't really look.
In 2011, Dorset ghost investigators asked the current homeowners if they experienced any poltergeist activity, and they said no.
Oh.
Well, there you go then. Maybe it's moved on now.
That was in 2011.
And with that, we return to Novimpia Heights, the scene of two more murders when I killed them both in cold fucking blood.
Right, so we're back at the Heights, back at the house.
Yeah.
That was a long day, wasn't it?
It was really nice though. You guys didn't see, we stopped off at a Nero, had a little bit of lunch and coffee.
Nice isn't the word I'd use to describe going around and looking at places where people were killed.
Yeah, but like we went out the house and we like went around places that I'd never been before.
We got out the house.
It pissed down with rain.
I thought the cemetery was really nice.
I thought the most really pretty. Interesting part was trying to find the Rattenbury graves personally, because that was sort of like a treasure hunt, wasn't it?
I thought that was going to take us half an hour, and it took.
I found it.
Minutes.
I was on a mission.
Yeah, you did very well actually. His wasn't going to be so hard to find, but we thought hers might be. It was a little tricky because it was so overgrown.
Mm.
But then I guess if people don't really give a shit about her,
yeah,
then no one's really going to tend to it. Although someone had left those silk flowers, which was slightly creepy.
Yeah, they didn't look particularly old either. Because normally, like old flowers like that, you can see there's sun bleached.
Yeah.
I think we did quite well with sort of like sneakily filming places where people could have been really annoyed with us.
Me and Shah kept getting really stressed out about you just going round with this massive fucking professional DSLR. Like,
professional journalists have just got to duck and dive and get in there, aren't they? Get your hands dirty.
You are neither professional nor a journalist, but there were times when Nova was like, oh, should we?
She's a journalist, ladies and gentlemen.
I know what you're at. When Nova was like, I think we should just use like a phone here.
Yeah, and we suggested a couple of times, like, should we just use our phone for this? But you were like, no!
And you went storming grow through up. That like, obnoxious what's
if someone's
going to
say leave, then we would just leave. Like, let's just risk it, God.
So you'd be filming people's houses.
So I kind of wanted to speak to someone about the potential that they didn't know that they were living in like a creepy house, but that could have really gone a bit awry. So
yeah,
we didn't, but we hope that you enjoyed that journey around Bournemouth. I'm sure there are other places that we could go to maybe next year, shall we? We'll do it again, eh? Yeah,
we could do one specifically about the paranormal, because this only had one paranormal thing. Yeah.
Where did you want to go that one time? God, these have got bigger, haven't they?
Castle.
Yeah, it's Knowlton Church. It's a church.
Yeah, a church. Yeah, maybe we'll go there.
But it's like ruined, and there's like a really creepy, like witchy poo, like bush thing that you go in, and it's like where people leave like offerings and stuff.
Kate Bush.
Not Kate Bush, no.
So, thank you for coming. Let us know in the comments what you've done for Halloween, if you've enjoyed our tour around Bournemouth, and if you'd like us to do a follow-up of sorts. There is one just on Patreon for the patrons of a tour around Bournemouth that we've done, which pertains to areas that are of our interest to us.
Olympia-centric areas of interest.
Where we filmed the furniture video, where we filmed, like, the Pecker's Chicken Farm, all that old
school
shit.
Where we first met.
This is where we first met. So, yes, if you'd like to join us on the Patreon and become a cultist of the Novimpia Patreon, there'll be a message afterwards.
Insert that little, like, guitar riff.
Ow! I just did. and if you'd like to follow us on social media, it's coming up here. But again, if you can't be asked, then don't, because who can? Well, Nova
I want the followers.
Nova's so desperate for... Well, so are you, though, as well.
I would like the followers.
I wouldn't.
Okay, anyway. We've got some patron birthdays to announce. So, for October 22nd, Sarah, who sent me a message, and she wasn't quite sure if she was successfully put into the Novimpia calendar, which she wasn't, which we're not sure. Right. We're not sure whose fault that was. So, Sarah, we'll say it's our fault, so I do apologise.
Happy birthday, Sarah.
Happy birthday for October 22nd.
Happy birthday.
This year, and indeed last year.
Right.
Because you would have had that birthday last year as well, Sarah.
What about next year?
And for then, darling. October 23rd.
We have Gillian M.
Happy birthday, darling.
Happy birthday, love.
October 27th.
Scarlet Crypt.
No.
Well, I'll do that one anyway for Halloween. That's a great one. I'm assuming that's your drag name for Halloween.
Scarlet Crypt. October 22nd, Margarita. Happy birthday, Margarita. But yes, for Halloween...
It's 27th. You just said 22nd.
7th.
You said 22nd.
You said 2nd to me.
We'll go back and the tape will have caught that.
God, this is a disaster.
But for Halloween, it's Scarlet Crypt and also Daniel. Happy birthday for you too as well.
Happy birthday, Daniel.
Oh, God. Listen,
what a mess.
We're gonna call it a day now. Nova's made some pumpkin soup.
Yes. Why are you pulling faces?
What? That'll be where it ends then.
Join our Patreon, make your parents not proud.